Blackstone Audio presents Winged Creatures by Roy Freirich. For a bird of the air will carry your voice, or some winged creature tell the matter. Ecclesiastes 10:20. Go, 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 said the bird. Humankind cannot bear very much reality. T.S. Eliot, Four Quarters. A function of speed and distance, the trajectory of a bullet in its last stages resembles an arc, succumbing over time to the force of gravity. If the target is at point-blank range, the effect of gravity on the trajectory of the bullet, for all practical purposes, can be described as nil. Donald Hank, Ph.D., Handgun Ballistics. Fledglings. Laraby. Distracted is barely the word for Laraby today, because as he exits Carby's restaurant, pausing outside the little water-stained stucco box of a place with his jumbo Joe to go, he wonders if he ever picked up his change. Wait, was there change at all? He hesitates, and then laughs to himself and juggles keys and coffee to hit the auto unlock button on his key ring. His little black Mercedes chirps cheerfully back at him and gives its lights a quick flash, and he climbs in and drives a little too fast to his noon shift down Route 89, along the edge of Hunt Landing and this row of ugly prefab fast food spots. He eases up for the underpass beneath I-94, Detroit one way, Ypsilanti the other, in case that rookie Michigan highway patrolman with his parket too big is waiting again just the other side, with his heater going on and a coffee of his own, and maybe a crossword puzzle. Or worse, his radar gun up and ready. Larrabee's late now. 2-3 minutes. No big deal, but it's the principle. Especially when your father was chief attending and founding partner. You don't want staff saying you're taking advantage of the fact week one of ER residency, which they will in a heartbeat. From the aides to the honchos and old hands who worked with Laraby Sr. In the hospital lot, Laraby glides into his new spot, farthest from the entrance, but still first row, there beside the big sedans of the surgical chiefs and administrators. He climbs out with his coffee, shutting the door behind him, liking the pricey, solid sound of perfectly designed latches meeting and catching, all machined to within millimeter tolerances. Inside, he clips along and has almost gained the stairwell when Chief of Emergency Surgery, Travis Carlson, rounds the corridor corner, spots him, and slows. Preternaturally tanned and tall, Carlson looks 20 years younger than he is, nowhere near old enough to have been Larrabee's dad's colleague and founding partner in the Hunt Landing Medical LLC. Carlson stands with the big-boned, laconic bearing of a Midwestern duffer, nicely settled into his own, and this is his turf, beyond any need to prove it to anyone, ever. From whence, his easy confidence and boundless good humor.
Bruce, I'm hearing good things.
Carlson's smile as he pauses is bland and obligatory, his mind probably already on the weekend.
Well, I had a scout knife cut that needed suturing and a broken leg to ship up to orthopedics. No rocket science. Good hand so far.
Rolex glinting, he half lifts a hand in an absent wave as he strolls off. Approaching the ER nurse's station, Laraby has planned a quick, busy smile and an offhand greeting, friendly enough but not particularly inviting, since give 'em an inch, they'll take a mile, has been his observation of conversation with these girls. They are a stiff-coiffed, whippet-thin Ypsilanti housewife with a prematurely aged face and a borderline obese black commuter from West Detroit with a big, booming laugh and a ready smirk. In a word, trouble. Their chatter is littered with the pop culture vernacular of the times, girlfriend and bad hair day and talk to the hand, punctuated with the whoops and high fives endlessly recycled on so many reality television shows with their adolescent dramas of rejection and loyalty and betrayal. Today, they're standing in the waiting area, among a hushed crowd bunched before the big black wall-mounted television, and curiosity stops Laraby and draws him closer as the crowd shifts and murmurs, and a few hands flutter to a few mouths to stifle gasps.
Laraby feels that prickly burst of tension at the thought that some giant catastrophe has again befallen us all, with its immediate toll of human flesh and blood, and the days and weeks and months that presumably follow, of layers of shock and grief, and their potentially irrevocable after-effects. He presses in, trying to see around the big hair of one of the temp girls from HR. From outside, even now, Laraby can hear the thwack-thwack of a helicopter and the crazed sirens dopplering off down distant county roads, and he guesses his beeper will be paging him within the minute. On the TV's little screen, Laraby can make out squad cars pulled up at haphazard angles, doors left open. SWAT cops in Kevlar inch along an exterior wall of a stucco and glass fast food restaurant, and his eyes narrow in astonishment to read Carby's right there in those balloon style.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.